Tom, I'm going to pass that down there and start with you. Going into this race in the past, we've always had an early skirmish between punters and bookmakers, normally with a Mullins hot pot. But this time around, even though Mellon's towards the top of the market, it's a little bit more open than previous years.
Yeah, I think this year looks very different. previous years, yeah, Min last year, we've had some horses coming with a huge reputation. Actually, chatting to the trading guys this morning, their view is that Ballyandy is now into fives, having been as large as 11s, having won at Newbury or Betfair Hurdle. They think that could actually go a favourite. So two horses back with us recently, Ballyandy into fives, and there's been a decent amount of money, as you're looking at odds check it, across the board on Neon Wolf today, into eights. I guess prospect of softest ground they might have on day one. Clearly, punters think there's a decent chance that Neon Wolf could go for the Supreme rather than the Neptune later in the week. Let's say Ballyandy, I think, might be our worst result of the week as early as the first race.
Okay, got plenty of time to get it back then if it is. What about Mellon? Because there was that little scare, like there was with Mid, of course, 12 months ago. Do you sort of sense some slight unease generally about the horse?
Certainly nothing like as confident as previous years. I think people are going to back it in the first race just because it's Willie Mullins and it's running in the Supreme. But I don't think we are particularly scared of it. 130 for us, I mean, you can get bigger. You can get as big as 9-2. So, you know, I think he will be backed. He will probably go our favourite. Although, you know, as I say, for us, the money horse is certainly has been Ballyandy for the last couple of weeks.
I'm going to pass this right down to the end to Matt, just because fill us in a little bit about the sort of the backdrop that we should have, because you've got a clash really here potentially if Moonracer turns up as well, which is obviously a question mark, about two champion bumper winners
absolutely.
Coming up against sort of what's become the more traditional Willie Mullins once or twice racehorse. How do the two sort of camps compare historically?
Well, a lot's been made about the fact that no horse has won this off one hurdles run since Flown. I think what's less been emphasised is the fact the last eight winners have all run at least four times over hurdles. So Mellon's, I've had the schooling hurdles that have been touted up at Durlers, Tipperary, places like that. But he is conceding a lot in the way of experience. And for those of you who followed Ken Pitterson in the Weekender, he said he was pretty green in the ring at Leopardstown. So you'd have to be a little bit concerned about the lack of experience. It was a bit of an egg and spoon race that he won. I just wonder, he's been a bit uneasy, and a lot of that is just the way the exchanges work, but there was a horse called 5-3, some of you will remember, who won the Neptune off one run, who was a last-minute switch by Willie, and they go a lot more steadily in the Neptune. Galileo won that off one run as well. And I just wonder if, depending on how that Willie's A-team shapes up, he will consider that, because it would be a lot easier a race just for Mellon in the first part of the race. Now, the way Willie works is he likes to have an A team, and at the moment it appears to be Mellon in that, Bacardi's, and then Augusta Kate in the Albert Bartlett. But Bunkoff Early is an interesting horse. He's probably got to run in this. He was a miler on the flat for Andy Oliver, isn't going to get further. So it'd be interesting to follow the vibes on that in the run up to the meeting, because if for whatever reason, say Bacardi's, who he was originally thinking of as an Albert Bartlett horse, isn't quite going as well, and Bunkoff Early is, I could see a late Mellon defection. So if you are a Mellon fan, he certainly this morning was 16-1 non-runner no bet for the Neptune, and just having a little saver in that medium might not be a bad idea.
Jerry, I mean, Nicky's got a few potential runners here. I presume the older horses are more likely to line up, the likes of sort of Beyond Conceit. Would that be a runner?
Yeah, definitely. He actually worked on Saturday, and Corky Brown, who'd be an old stalwart in Seven Barrows, he was of the opinion he was a 2 miler on the flat for Andrew Balding. So he kind of thought he wants 2.5. So he was kind of hoping that he'd go for the Neptune. But I think Nicky is adamant he might go 2 miles. I think the ground could depend as well, because he does like soft ground. But I think he could be lining up in the Supreme.
He also didn't overly settle at Ascot. Is some of the thoughts that the faster tempo of the 2 miles of the Supreme might help in that regard as well?
Yeah, exactly. He's a big horse. He's a very, very strong forward-going horse. And like I said, I think the speed of the 2 miles the first day would suit him. To be fair, River Wild, he was very impressive in the Dovecot at Kempton last week. The plan is for him to line up, and he's entitled to be there. Just looking here, he's 14-1. He could be a bit overpriced at that, really. You know, he's done nothing wrong. His profile is improving. whether he'd be good enough or not is he has to step up again. He won a grade two the last day. A step up to grade one company now is another big step forward, but he's entitled to be there, and I think he's overpriced at 14-1.
Okay, so he might be a little bit over. So just before we come to selections for this, just give us a feel. You're saying, you know, the horses are working at the moment, the final preparation's been done. We're now, what, sort of between 7 to 12 days out. What sort of work is being done? When's the final work? How many horses are you working? Where are they going, etc.?
Well, yesterday morning, Saturday, we was probably the last proper piece they would do up the grass gallops between now and Cheltenham. They'd work again just to kind of keep the pipes open, things like that, but it would probably just be on the all-weather gallops. But yesterday morning, now, I'd say it was probably the guts of 60 horses, if not more, worked with Cheltenham in mind, you know, and they would have had their last proper piece on the grass.
And is that still done by those that ride them at home, or is there now an influx of the riders who are likely to be partnering them on the day, or are they sort of kept out of it until race day?
Well, thankfully it wasn't just jockeys riding work, because I think we'd have been there all morning. If that was the case, we definitely wouldn't have made it racing. But no, to be fair to Nicky, he's got a good bunch of staff who know what they're doing, and he really does trust them, and like I said, they know what they're sitting on.
Okay, so let's have some selections. Who would you like to ride? Give us one of Nicky's, or you're allowed to choose elsewhere. Nicky doesn't do Facebook Live on top, so you're right.
To be honest, I do find Move of the Times very interesting. We were just speaking beforehand. I don't think we're 100% sure where he goes. I thought he'd run a big race in the Betfair, which he did, and I think he'll improve a bit more for better ground. He's one of those horses. He could run in the Supreme, but yet he could turn up in a handicap as well. But he's one horse now I would be just keeping a very close eye on.
Yeah, there's not much between him on a couple of lines of form with Mally Andy as well. Tom, who?
Exactly.
Who would you selection at this stage?
Well, I'd throw in one at a massive price, very speculative each way, Sir Anthony Brown, who would have run, Alan King's, would have run on the Storm Doris day here, and our traders were already wary of it. We'd gone 33s when there was bigger prices elsewhere. There's still a bit of 66s. I think better ground, 66-1, non-runner, no bet, looks quite an interesting, you know, shout in a very open first race.
Okay, I'll pass it down the end here as well. Where would your money go, or would it not?
I'm with Jerry. I like Move with the Times. I think Paul described him as pretty green. He certainly looked at Wincanton, even on the run in the Betfair Hurdle. It took a little bit of a while for the penny to drop. He was giving Bally Andy a pound, went down by three quarters of a length. Now, Bally Andy's got a lot more experience from bumpers and from hurdles. So you could argue you'd expect him to improve a bit more, and yet he's twice the price for a horse with very similar form. As Jerry said, the good ground might help him. I'm not convinced it's going to be as soft as everyone thinks it is. It does dry out very, very quickly. So often you hear it described as good to soft ground. The last 3 years it's been good fast ground on the first day.
Moonracer and Neon Wolf, we haven't really touched on. I don't want to dwell too long on the race, but again, they've put potential alternative engagements. Where do you sense the vibes are? Moonracer for the champion and Neon Wolf for the Neptune, or do we see that switching slightly?
I think that with Moonracer. With Neon Wolf, I thought he was definitely going for the Neptune, but the vibes today have been different. I think he could be really well suited by the Super 8.
Do you think that's just the rain, though? Do you think people are putting...
I think it's too early to say just a bit of rain today with the forecast. I mean, we've seen often you get three or four dry days, and it really does dry out quickly. You get a bit of breeze and it's mild. So I wouldn't have thought that would be too much of a problem, but he was a really quick horse, wasn't he, in the Rossington Main? Mm. And I think that the tempo of the Supreme might suit him quite well. They go pretty steadily in the Neptune, and some of the horses, he might just get a little bit keen in that. But yeah, I really like him. As all the novices, Death Duty included, I think he's the most exciting long-term prospect.
Okay, so that's various names for the Supreme. There's only really one name we want to focus on probably for the second race, the Racing Post article, and Jerry can hold centre stage here probably, because it is Altior, who has been one of the two stars of the season, certainly the stars of the season this side of the Irish Sea. Have you ever been on him at home when Nico was sidelined? How does it work? Do you get to sit on him?
Yeah, to be fair, I've sat on him a few times. I've been lucky enough to school him a few times too. Like, I hate the saying when people say you might as well give the horse the trophy now, but and I'd rarely say it about a horse in a race, especially Cheltenham, but I just can't see him getting beat. Last week, it was on a Friday, we had a schooling session, and I followed him. And I say followed him because nothing actually goes upside him schooling, because nothing can go with him. So I just followed him on horse, and he's frightening. No, he's just the stride he has, the amount of ground he covers over a fence, it's incredible, really. Like when people start to compare him to Sprinter Sacker, you really have to sit up and take notice, because he was the best way to describe Altior to people, he's a freak. He's one of those horses that he's improving from run to run. Like the last at Newbury, taking on not novice company first time, and he just destroyed him, you know. I know it's Cheltenham, I know he still has to jump around, but I just, as much as he is a good horse, I don't see many other horses take him on. That's the other thing, you know. I think I heard yesterday Charbel, I think he goes,
yeah.
I like to be fair, I'll be very good friends with Dave Bass now too, and he'll be gunning for it, you know. He will set the stall out, he will go a good gallop, and he'll put Altior's jumping under pressure, but I just can't see any flaws, you know. And I even think 1-4 is probably a great price about him. He'd probably be shorter on the day.
What is it? I mean, take us through the history of Altior with the stable, really, because I mean, he's got an owner who is our first horse, I think, for about 15 years. So if you're not, it wasn't going, presumably this is passed over by a few of Nicky's owners originally to end up in that sort of camp. So not necessarily the best of lookers of the younger horse. So what's really thrust him to the fore?
Yeah, it's probably a good point, because to be fair, Nicky buys most of his horses from the store sales on spec. He'd have orders, fair enough, but he wouldn't have, people wouldn't have picked out what they want before the sales. You know, Nicky would buy the horses, he'd break them, he'd get them going, get them cantering, and then he'd get owners in to have a look at them and see what they thought. To be fair, even as a store horse, I think he was a big, imposing, good-looking horse, but we never thought he'd be a two-miler and show the speed that he does show. But like you said, Mrs. Pugh, she's been very lucky, you know. She's really picked up a good one here. He wasn't a very expensive store horse, but he's turned out to be a good one so far.
Tom, how does it, you know, how as a bookmaker do you get more interest into this race? Because we're all very interested in it, in terms of obviously all hoping that Altior really struts his stuff. He's one with the loss of horses we've had this year for the festival. You know, you want your superstars to perform on the day. So, you know, what sort of angles do you take to try and generate some revenue?
I mean, the trading guys will probably kill me, but I would have thought you have to take him on at 2-7. I don't think there's a huge danger otherwise. And, you know, things do happen at Cheltenham. He's still an inexperienced horse. That said, he'd be favourite for the champion hurdle if you ran in that. The form of the Supreme last year, I've just got it up. I mean, Min second, Bouvardaire, you know, virtually joint favourite for the champion. Tombstone beat Jeske the other day. Charbel second. Mr. Miyagi, champion hurdle, Super Sunday, who I really fancy for whatever race he turns up in. I mean, it is a red-hot race, and he absolutely annihilated them. His jumping just got better and better the faster he went, you know, I thought when he won at Newbury. You know, it is very, very difficult to see him get beaten. I hope the bookmakers try and get him beaten at 2-7. I back Charvel each way, I think 12-1. Non-run, no bet, in case he goes and runs in the JLT, I think is a very decent bet. The danger with that is he's going to try and put it up to Altior, and you can see him, you know, jumping the last somewhere near Altior and maybe coming fourth. But I think Charbel is the second best horse in the race. You know, he's beaten top notch already. He's got some cracking festival form. Even if you want, we go non-run and no bet without Altior, and Charbel's 5-2. So maybe actually, you know, one of the few bookmakers who go non-run and no bet in the market without Altior, 5-2 looks a decent bet on Charbel. But yeah, tricky to see anything other than Altior winning by 12 lengths.
Matt, is there anything in the stats, or are we just passing this over as Altior and let's all enjoy him and, you know, celebrate what hopefully will be a great clash when he finally meets Duva?
Yeah, definitely just enjoy him. I mean, Min's injured, York Hill's going to duck the issue, Identity Pete bombed out today. There's nothing in his class at all. I like Charbel as well. He's obviously come back from having been coughing. He was pretty keen the first time this season, so I'd just be a little bit worried about that. The only flaw I could possibly see is if it came up really bad ground and he got outstayed, because he is such a quick horse. The one horse I quite fancy for that, waiting patiently, has been scratched today.
Yeah.
I just don't think these will be good enough to test him. So keep your money in your pockets and enjoy.
Yeah, that's part of what the festival's about, isn't it? Enjoying class, you know, we might all tip a winner on day one, which is very welcome as well. We're going to move on to the feature race on day one, the champion hurdle, but I'm going to slightly merge it with the race that follows as well, the OLBG Mayor's Hurdle, because obviously, as has been made the point, Altior would have started favourite for the champion hurdle, and I probably think, Tom, that maybe four horses I could immediately think of: Faheen, Annie Power, Altior, and obviously if Duvan, you know, would potentially have started favourite for this year's champion and aren't in it. Just before we start, Limini and Vroom Vroom Mag obviously also hold the mare's hurdle entry. Vroom Vroom Mag's also already entered in the champion hurdle, but Limini isn't. Where do you see the Mullins horses going just before we start talking about the champion? Because obviously the two are interlinked.
Yeah, I don't know. Jerry may have a slightly better idea than me. I mean, in terms of prices, we make Yanworth just favourite. 130, Bouvardet 7-2. And clearly he's got, you know, JP's got others in that race as well, in terms of My Tent or Yours, who actually, again, very interested to hear what Jerry thinks. He was 40-1 with the sponsor a week or so ago, and I actually backed him each way. He's been second the last 2 years. If you go and watch last year's Champion Hurdle, I mean, he was tanking the whole way through, and he only got beaten by Annie Power, superstar, getting weight. I got the impression that, sort of seen by those behind the scenes as a bit of forgotten horse this year. So, and there has been a bit of money for My Tent or Yours, and he's now only 20-1. So yeah, I'll be very interested to see who rides what, and Jerry will be able to tell us. And Limini is the big mover in recent days, since he beat Apple's Jade, now into 11-2 with us. I find it a very, very difficult race to be confident that any of Yanworth, Bouvardet, Petit Mouchoir, Brain Power, you know, are better than each other. So I think, you know, My Tent of Yours, being there, got the T-shirt, a decent each way price would be the bet for me.
Okay, so as I mentioned, Jerry, let's bring Jerry in as well. I don't expect you to know exactly where the Mullins horses might go, but let's try and unpick some of the Henderson horses. Bouvardet started off over fences and obviously was the horse that returned back. Was there any specific reason why that occurred? Was he not as electric at schooling or what have you, or was it just partly because Altior was there?
Well, I suppose, to be fair, at the start of the season, the boss, Nicky, he wanted to actually go keep Bouvardet over hurdles. I think the owners and a few other people wanted to kind of just get a few more novice chases, especially 2 mile novice chases. I think they lacked a bit and they wanted to kind of go down that route. To be fair, Bouvardet, he's 2 from 2 over fences. He at Warwick the last day, he probably just ran a bit flat, and they just probably thought he was going to struggle realistically against Altior, if you look at it that way, because he would have run in the Arkle. And obviously then they just thought that the champion hurdle was wide open basically at the time. Obviously he won a grade one at Aintree last year over hurdles, so he's definitely entitled to be head of the market for the champion this year.
Brain Power is a horse that's coming from a slightly different profile, in the sense that he's been picking his way through handicaps. He was involved in that piece of work the other day at Kempton, and on the face of it worked well, but Nicky was keen to sort of downplay that and say he is a good workhorse generally. Has he got the class for a race like this?
Yeah, like I've done a few of these previews now, and if someone had said to me at the start of the season that Brain Power be in the top 3 or 4 in the betting for the champion hurdle, I would have told them to change career, because, you know, you won't be a bookmaker or a punter. But the horse is entitled to line up. He's been very impressive in 2 handicaps this year. I've actually finished 2nd to him both times, more recently at Ascot. He travelled very well through those races. That's another thing. It is a big step forward going from a very competitive handicap to a grade one. But off 162, an official handicap mark, he has to do it. It's the next port of call, and I think we'll know a lot more. I think there'll be 1 or 2 better than him, to be honest. But back to Bouvardet and Yanworth, I'd be very keen just to wait for the ground, because I do think Bouvardet is a much better horse with a cut in the ground. He actually worked yesterday morning and worked extremely well. And then back to My Tent to Yours, that's a very interesting point. And I can see why he has shortened in the betting, because his work over the last two and a half weeks has been very, very good.
Have you had a clear run with him this time around? Because obviously he'd been plagued in the past when he's run one champion hurdles by interrupted preps.
Exactly, that's my next point. He's not the easiest horse to train, and it's probably, as like all of us, you know, as years goes on, it just finds it a bit harder to get out of bed in the morning without any niggles. And to be fair, in the last month, he's been brilliant. His work has been extraordinary. He worked around Kempton last Tuesday on the all weather, and he didn't come off the bridle. You know, he really is in a great place, and before he's ran a few of these citation bridles and things like that, and as far as I know, he won't be running them at Cheltenham. You know, they're just running a normal bridle. He's settling a lot better at the moment. I think he's just got a bit older and wiser and just kind of realised, you know, he can't just take his time. Like you said, very good point. He's finished second twice the last 2 years. He's entitled, like, he's not even on the paper here. That's what I find very hard to believe, you know. And even at 20-1, I think it's whoever got 40-1 I'd be very happy, put it that way.
Okay, so we shouldn't rule him out. Just finally, just going back to the answer you gave me about brain power, about, you know, you wouldn't have put him anywhere near this sort of class. What were the attributes then that worried you about him, and have they been overcome, or are they still nagging in the back of your mind?
Well, back to what you said earlier about, like, Nicky commenting on his work. He's always been a very good workhorse, and that's probably why he was a small bit disappointing last year as a novice. I know he won his novice and he was second or third at Punchdown in a grade one. But on his homework, you'd have thought he'd have won a champion hurdle last year, if you know what I mean. He's an extraordinary workhorse. He's another horse. He actually schooled over fences at the start of the year, but I think they just kind of looked down. There was a few good 2 mile handicaps to be won, and they decided to go down that route. Like I said, he's an impressive horse at home, and this year he's been proving on the track. But like I just have to go back to the point, it's a big step up from a competitive handicap into a grade one, but at the same time he's entitled to do it.
And rather than me revisit you for your selection at the end, who would you prefer or favour at this stage as the most likely winner?
Like, I do think Limini will be supplemented, I think, won't she? I presume she'll be supplemented this week. But to be honest, I'm not just sitting on the fence now, but I'd love to know exactly what the ground would be Tuesday,
okay,
March. But I'd be very slow to get off Boover there. I think he's a great chance if the ground just came up good to soft.
Okay. Matt, this race has got all sorts of uncertainties in it, not least who may end up running.
Yeah.
How can you point us in the right direction for what looks a sort of very open, not vintage, but an open renewal?
Absolutely, it's open, and it might actually afterwards look like a really good renewal. A lot of people have been saying it's not a good renewal, but you've got a lot of second season hurdlers who are unexposed on the up. If a couple of them finish 10 lengths clear of the pack, it might turn out to be a very good race. I think there are two different betting strategies. I think Jerry made the crucial point about the ground. I won't repeat that, but there are a few of these you want to see the ground. You'd also think about the jumping. Beauvoir Dare's come back from jumping fences. He's had a bit of a hack round on slow ground. That's very different from what's going to happen here, assuming Petit Mouchoir lines up. Yamworth's jumping issues are well documented. Limini's just had a run round of 2.5 miles on heavy ground. She had a lot of jumping issues last year as a novice. They're going to go very quickly here. And this is one of the four championship races where you tend to get upsets. Hardy Eustace 33s, Punjabi 22s, Sublimity 16s. And that part of that is that they go so much quicker than in the trials. You know, if you look at the Champion Chase, they go similar gallop, ground permitting, to the Tingle Creek. And some of these, I think, I would be worried about how their jumping will hold up. So two strategies. One is to wait for the day, look at the ground. I think Beauvoir Dare definitely wants soft ground. I think the other one interesting on soft ground will be Footpad. The five-year-olds have a shocking win record, but actually in recent years they've got quite a good each-way record at big prices, Countrywide Flame, Afsoon, horses like that. And another one at a big price, if it's much better ground, is the other Munir Hill horse, So Royale, who travels well, jumps well. Alan King was very disappointed in the Kingwell. It seems to think he left him a bit short. He might be interested on that. But if you want to bet now, I think I'd keep it simple. This race reminds me a bit of a couple of recent renewals of the Champion Chase, which Dodging Bullets and Cider Grugy won. Everyone was saying, oh, it's a weak renewal. The normal trials, the Tingle Creek and the Clarence House, they won those very easily. The form isn't up to much. But it was actually by far the best form for second season horses on the up. Now, if you look at Nichols Canyon last year, he was beaten less than 5 lengths off an interrupted preparation in a strong renewal of this. He came out bolted up in the Morgiana, the first grade one. Now, he's probably better at Punchestown than Leopardstown. But he's won 2 grade ones at Leopardstown. He does act there. And he's been run over twice by Petit Mouchoir, who's been absolutely transformed since forcing tactics we used. Last year, when he was chinned by Beauvoir Dare in the top novices, he pulled like a train for 3/4 of a mile and ruined his chance. Now, Brian's got to get the fractions right out front. He's got to take the occasion. He is a buzzy type. But if he does do that, in what have been the best two trials, the Irish Champion and the Ryanair over the last 20 years, he's the form horse for this year, and there's a good case for this year's form, and I know Cheltenham form is very important, the champion hurdle, but on this year's form there's a good case for saying he should be favourite. He's 6-1, and the front ones at the front of the market, I'd definitely be with him.
Okay, so there's a range of views, and no surprise really, to be honest, that the champion throws that up. I'll stay with you, Matt, for the rest of the card, because what we'll do is just briefly scan over any interesting horses. The remaining races on the card are a mare's race, which I mentioned, which presumably will be at the mercy of whichever one of the Ricci pair does not get moved to the champion hurdle. The Ultima Handicap Chase, the National Hunt Chase over 4 miles, JT McNamara race this year, and the 2.5 mile Novices Handicap Chase. So take your pick, and if you feel obliged to mention, you know,
I'll just do a couple. Yes, I definitely agree with you on the mare's race. In the 4 miler, jockeys are so important in this. It's hugely underrated how much of an advantage Derek O'Connor and Jamie Codd are. If you backed every horse Jamie Codd had ever ridden at the festival, you'd have made a 58% profit. If you backed every horse Derek O'Connor had ridden at the festival, you'd have made a 75% profit. Derek's on, looks like he's going to be on Ed Wolf, who was X-rated jumper early. He jumped really well at Nace the other day, recorded an RPR of 157, winning a valuable handicap off an Irish mark of 145. That RPR is higher than any horse has brought into the race and won. I think if you've got to be a bit worried about his jumping, but Derek's brilliant at judging pace. Get him settled out the back in the rhythm of the 4 miler, I think he can win that. And just one of the handicaps, if he gets in, I like Brother Ted. He's nearly a stone below his hurdles form. If you actually look at his chasing form, he's been running against horses like Different Gravy, who looked really good on that day and then have had problems, and his form might have been a bit underestimated. He's on 136, he's right on the bubble. He's the 31st in the entries. Last year, the first 27 got a run. But if he gets in, I think he's got a good chance, and he's about 16-1.
Okay, so there's a couple of names in the other races. Anything you might be riding, Jerry, or has caught your eye down the season?
One in the JT McNamara is the 4 miler, which unfortunately is an amateur race, but is a horse called Beware the Bear. He's a horse, I've won the last 4 on him. He's an improving horse. I think he loved the trip, and especially if the ground comes up on the soft side, I think at 10-1 he'll take an awful lot of beating. He's a very progressive novice, and I think he's crying out for 4 miles. Like, we kind of see him as a future national horse, so I think this would be a nice stepping stone towards that, you know.
Who'd be in the line to ride?
I'm not too sure, to be honest. There's a few amateurs in the yard, but I'll stay out of the politics side of that, you know.
Without answering diplomatically, who would you like to see ride? Have you got good, you know, in terms of an amateur we might not have heard of or impressed you at home, etc.?
Yeah, there's a very good lad at home called Hugo Hunt. He rode a few winners in the flat for Andrew Balding. He's with Nicky now 12 months. He's ridden a few winners for Nicky, but he's an amateur he won't be an amateur too much longer, put it that way. He'll be turning professional, and he'll probably get the leg up. You know, he's more than capable. But I think a 10-1, he's a great price.
Okay, Tom, anything money-wise that you've seen of significance over the last few days for horses that in those 4 races?
Yeah, money-wise, we've seen money for Champers on Ice in the National Hunts into 17-2. Got to have a decent chance, I would have thought. I mean, I love these handicaps on day one. In terms of my preferences, it looks like Dan Skelton's got great chance with a couple in the Close Brothers. I like It's a Freebie, who was third in last year's Neptune. Looks to have a great chance. We've definitely seen some money for previous festival winners in Hollywell and Maldini in the Ultima. I think Hollywell, I mean, weighted with Antonio Porto on his second last year, looks to have a great chance. And Single Farm Payment, if he gets into that same race. I mean, definitely got good course form, bought down and going very well last time out. That's our 10-1 second favourite in the Ultima behind Noble Endeavour of Gordon Elliott's. But I think It's a Freebie and Hollywell look quite interesting for me.
Yeah, funny enough, they'd be exactly the same two I'd mentioned for that day. I think some of the point we were making about horses that come back repeat bids, when you get a good horse that can run well at the festival, often you target it, and Hollywell's been virtually a case in point, really. Be £5 lower than when second last year, goes AWOL in the autumn and returns to form with a vengeance in the spring, normally starting with this race. So certainly be one to consider there. Okay, let's roll our way on to day two, and then we'll have a break after that. So see what we've got for the Neptune. So far, it's been the race that we haven't really had quite the strong Irish contingent right at the top of the market, Matt. So Neil Wolf and Finian's Oscar are the two that have really impressed, I suppose, going forward to this. If we assume that they run here, which is a question mark, obviously, for Neon Wolf in particular, you've already been positive about Neon Wolf. Do you think this is his race?
I'm very positive about him generally. I quite like to see him in the Supreme, actually. I think this is a stronger race. I think you're right about the Irish. I'm not sure they're strong. I have a rule of thumb in this, that if any horse is being talked about running in this or the Albert Bartlett, it's not quick enough. And the Neptune, although it's 2.5, you look at Forheen, Harley Eustace, Sister Brack, it's been a champion hurdle trial. But some of the great stayers of the modern age, like Denman and English Dreamer, have got thumb for toe in this. And they tend to go quite steadily, and it's a real test of speed. And the horses with the 2 mile form, like Finian's Oscar and Neon Wolf, I think they're the two that will fight it out. Finian's Oscar looks a little bit more the finished article to me. Of the two of them. It was interesting, for those of you who follow Richard Pugh on ATR and the Irish Angle, he was saying in the autumn that in his point, and he only won his maiden point in the autumn, he put up a time that only Brindisi Breeze and Simonsic have matched in the last decade. You know, this is a really fast horse. I think it's between the two of them. If there is going to be an outsider, one interesting one, and Jerry will be able to give us some insight on this, is William Henry. He's a 25-1 shot. Now, he was outstayed by Holstone in the Classic, which is the 2.5 mile grade two at the trials meeting. And that's usually, as this year, run on really heavy ground. And we've seen the new one got outstayed by At Fisher's Cross in that. Messini's Maguire got outstayed by Wichita Lyman, and they came on and won this race. He travelled really well in that. He is a 7-year-old, so he might not have quite the scope for improvement of some of the others. But he's got the right sort of profile for it, and if you wanted one more at a price, it'd be him. If I was going to have a bet at the moment, now with the possibility of Neon Wolf not running, I'd definitely be backing Finian's Oscar.
Okay. Jerry, a couple of things. Let's start with the Nicky horses. There's quite a few that hold entries here. Any idea what the pecking order might be?
Well, William Henry, he's definitely going for the Neptune, as far as I know. One horse that he won around here, it's a horse called Burbank. Ronnie Bartlett owns him. He's a nice horse by Yates. He's probably going to line up. On official ratings, he probably is a few pound wrong, but you know, he's bumped into one or two. He's won a bumper this year and a novice hurdle, and he's finished second twice. The latest was up in Musselburgh on trials day when the ground was very quick and the track was a bit sharp. He actually worked with William Henry yesterday at home, and they both worked very well together. Good point. I think William Henry is a good solid bet. I do think he'll appreciate a bit more of a cut in the ground, and if we do get kind of softer ground, even good to soft, he'll have a great chance. He'll end up being a nice staying type, but 2.5 would be perfect and right up his street, I think.
The other thing I wanted to mention is just a wider issue. For the first 2 days, we're obviously racing on the old course, and Matt was mentioning the Neptune can be a test of speed. Can you just explain, from a jockey's perspective, the differences between the old and new and the impact that can have?
Yeah, it can, and I suppose from punters' point of view and people at home, they probably don't appreciate it, you know. But even if you just walk around the track, you do notice there's a big difference, like, you know. But like back to Neon Wolf, I'm surprised they were talking about going 2 miles with him. I thought he'd definitely be going 2.5. I'm a massive fan of him, and more importantly, like, Noel Feely is a very big fan of him. He doesn't get excited very often, or he wouldn't show his emotions too much, but if you mention this horse's name, he just lights up. Opposite to Matt, I kind of see Finian's Oscar as more of a staying chaser and horse for the future. I think he'd run a big race in Neptune, but I think Neon Wolf, if I had the choice of riding either of them, I'd be riding Neon Wolf.
So you'd be sending Neon Wolf here and bringing up for the ride?
Yeah, exactly.
Perfect, okay. Tom, how do we bet here? Again, you've got this sort of unknown quantity with Neon Wolf potentially going elsewhere, but majority of the others, I think, are likely to line up here.
Yeah, we go 9-4 Neon Wolf, 4-1 Finian's Oscar, 5 Spicardi's, 9's Death Duty, that I think go Albert Bartlett's. Those are probably the three to concentrate on. I agree, I love Neon Wolf. I was so impressed when he won last time. I was sort of running away from, was it Elgin, Alan King's? I mean, it screams festival winner, and I think he should go for this race. The form of Finian's Oscar, 188 bet, sponsored down at Exeter when he won last time. Tours wasn't that far away and was beaten a very, very long way at Doncaster at the weekends. Capitaine finished nowhere. You know, some of Finian's Oscar's form doesn't necessarily... it's taken a couple of knocks.
And also, I believe those that follow the clock also suggest that the Tolworth might not have been the race in terms of time, which, you know, may or may not be significant, but given it's been let down, does raise the odd question mark.
Yeah, I think you can ask questions about Finian's Oscar's form, which I find it difficult to quibble with what Neon Wolf has done. I think non-runner, no bet, Neon Wolf, sort of around the 9-4 mark, at a relatively short price, looks a cracking bet. One point I will mention about 188 bet, the trading guys, are going to go best price Willie Mullins' horses on day two, on the day itself. So we will be taking on the likes of Bacardi's Augusta K invitation only in this, and we'll move on to the likes of Duvan later. But, you know, I think if you do fancy Bacardi's, you know, he might be an interesting bet on the day. He's clearly run well on the course, ran well in the bumper last year. So Neon Wolf looks the likely winner for me. But maybe Bacardi's could run well, run into a place.
Okay, keep the mic because we'll come straight on to Duvan. Just letting you know, I believe Augusta Gate may well be going for the Albert Bartlett, but again, that was from Ruby Walsh, but he did have the caveat that, you know, at the end of the day, Willie may still change his mind, but I believe that is the preferred option if you do fancy Augusta Gate. So, on to, I'm going to go to the RSA next, are we, as opposed to the, so let's go for the RSA. Let's go straight, actually, pass it to Tom to Jerry, because might bite. This horse probably polarises opinion more than anyone else in terms of, you know, is he a flat track bully? In any way, was that Kempton form, which after all has been franked, a fluke when he came down at the last, when he was well clear? But he is a short price favourite. So what are your views on him, Jerry?
Yeah, he is a short price favourite, he really, isn't he? Obviously, Kempton wasn't ideal, but it's racing, it's one of those things. Obviously, he didn't take on much and he had it fairly easy at Doncaster since. His jumping was grand, he got the job done. But he could be vulnerable. To be fair to him, in his defence though, he's schooled last Friday and he schooled extremely well. So he's got better and better the more he's done since Kempton. It was a nasty fall, but like I said, it's jump racing, it happens. Like I said, he could be vulnerable, but he's on form, he's entitled to be ahead of the betting. But one horse I'm a massive fan of, and I think he's one of the bets I'm eating, is Whisper. I just seeing here, he's 8-1. The last preview I did, he was 10-12-1, so someone must be listening, I'd say. He's a lovely horse, he's really, and he's just that bit older as well, you know. He went chasing the start of last season, he'd won run around Exeter, finished second. They decided to revert back to hurdles, keep his novice status, and it's worked well because he's two over fences this year. He hasn't ran since New Year's Day around Cheltenham, and that's another thing. He's course and distance form, which is a big thing around Cheltenham, because, you know, as much as it's a spectacle, it is a jumping track and you have to operate around the track. And he's fresh and well, like I said, he hasn't ran since the 1st of January. He's had this race in mind, or the JLT, but as far as I know, he does go to RSA. He's a stayer. He, like, you know, he won the entry hurdle over 3 miles, so he'll definitely be going for the RSA as far as I know. And of the two, if I had the choice, it would definitely Whisper.
Davey Russell rides Whisper, is that correct?
Yeah, exactly. And he knows him now at this stage too. You know, he gets on well with the horse. He gave him a cracking ride the last day. He's very patient on him. And I think over 3 miles, you could do that again. You know, you wouldn't have to force him. You could just take your time, get his jumping going. His jumping does warm up. You know, he's always a bit careful of the first few. But once he does warm up to it, I think he is a great shout.
Okay, so possibly Whisper might be a better value than Might Bite. How do you assess this race, Matt?
It's one of those races where I want to pose virtually everything. It's struggling to find a bet. I mean, Mike Bite, Nicky was interviewed by Mick Fitzgerald, and Mick asked him, how are you going to get him ready for the RSA after that experience at Kempton? And Nicky sort of went, well, we've got the will if he has. Which the whole tone of it was that he didn't think he was. He's by Scorpion, they've got a bit of a reputation for being a bit soft. So I was thinking about a place lay on him, but I'm just looking down it, I'm struggling to find too much opposition. Alpha Dezo Bo is a horse I can't have. Every year, I wouldn't mind a pound actually for every time I hear, oh, look at his Thistle Crack form. Every year the horses come from the stayers, more about time for Rupert, Grand Cru, Punches Downs, and they always get stuffed in this. And they had all turned up unbeaten. He's obviously burst a blood vessel badly at Leopardstown last time. Mouse Morris is an excellent target trainer, but you have to be an alchemist, I think, for this. It's interesting to hear Jerry very positive about Whisper. I mean, a nine-year-old who's just had a couple of runs, Davey was quite downbeat about him after his last run. I wouldn't be able to have him. I think Mini Home is the last one of those to have run. I was very keen on the Irish form of the three-mile Grade One at Leopardstown at Christmas. Unfortunately, Coney Island's now injured. Our Duke isn't coming. And it looks like Disco's going to go for the JLT, but I think he would be interesting if going for this instead. He dropped down to 2.5 miles on soft ground in the flow gas. The forcing tactics worked. Whether he could do that against the likes of York Hill, I'd be doubtful. So the non-runner no bet, he might be of interest. Eddie O'Leary wants him to run in this, so it'd be interesting to see how the dynamic works. It's one of those races I'm probably going to wait and see how it comes through at the six-day confirmation stage. One horse I wanted to ask Jerry about was 007, who was very impressive at Cheltenham in November, then won a handicap of 148. No horse has won a handicap at the festival off more than 148 this century, and he's now 152. So I assume handicaps are out. He didn't go a yard at Doncaster in between, but twice out of three he's been quite impressive. He's 25-1. Any chance for him?
Yeah, well, it's interesting because obviously he won his last race around Huntington, which obviously brings in a bit of horse form. I think Barry got off from that day at Huntington. He wasn't very impressive around here, but I think he just said the track was a bit sharp for him. Cheltenham would obviously suit him a lot better. He actually went to Kempton last Tuesday now. He worked. He's still in the RSA, but he's in some of the other handicaps as well, as far as I know, as in not the novice. I think he's in one of the straight handicaps.
He's off 152 though, it's a very high mark.
Yeah. It's one of those, he's kind of stuck between a rock and a hard place. Obviously we've got two or three in this race already. But like I said, it'll be interesting because even if the boss, if he does think Might Bite is a bit vulnerable, he might just run him, you know. He'd be worth taking his chance. But he's in great form, he's working well, and I definitely think the track would suit him. And obviously, he's another horse who's won around the course.
Yeah. Your vibe is he might not quite be good enough for this.
Probably, yeah. And I think they might just go for a handicap with him.
Right.
Okay, so that's a few thoughts on the RSA. And then we can probably save a little bit of time here with the Queen Mother. For Duvan, Reed Altior from the last time, you're going best price guaranteed for the Mullins horses. What do you think he will start at, Duvan? Guess the starting price.
Well, he's 1-4 now. Is he going to be slightly bigger? 1-3? I mean, you can't see him getting beaten. But yeah, the trading guys are keen to take a position. You know, I guess he's a very, very short price. You know, and you know, yeah, I think it's great. You would like to think that bookies will be happy to take those Altior and Duvan on at such short prices, but it is very, very difficult to see anything beating them. The horse we've seen a bit of each way money for was God's Own, who's obviously run very well in the race before, will like the better ground in the spring, always runs well. Beat Votor when Votor came down at Aintree, won that race, always runs well in this race. 12-1, obviously a decent enough each way race. Just one point about Alfa de Zobo. He is the horse that we have seen a lot of money for recently. Now into short of 6-1, the vibes are obviously very strong, and clearly a lot of people like that Thistlecrack form, but you know,
I think you'll keep seeing money for him too. I think he'll shorten. He might even challenge for favouritism.
Yeah,
I'm hoping so. So I can get that nice place layout.
But I say, you know, our trading guys are going to take on Duvan, but it is almost impossible to see him getting beaten. I fancy Duvan almost more than Altior, just because he's been there, he's done it, he's jumped around at festival speed. Altior hasn't. But say, God's Own, popular each way with us.
Jerry, anything to add on the Duvan side?
To be fair, I just think it's just one of those races, stating the obvious, it's not a betting race really, is it? It's just one of those, you just want to sit back, enjoy the race and hope everything goes according to plan and Duvan wins. Because I think from everyone's point of view, whether you're a punter, jockey, trainer, you'd love to see him win because on form, on ratings, he's the best horse in the race. You just hope nothing goes wrong and he jumps around and wins impressively. If you are looking for an each-way bet, I would be a fan of just a few good each-way on Special Tiara. Nowadays, but before he used to be very kind of forward going, he had to make the running, he was a bit kind of wild in one sense, but nowadays he's just a bit more relaxed, he's a bit more amenable, you couldn't just switch him off, and I think, you know, he could just run up the hill and be in the each way money, but it's a one horse race really.
Yeah, especially I'd certainly be suited by the old course, he wouldn't have been suited by the new when they moved the Clarence House.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Like you said, he's one of those horses. He turns up in these grade ones the whole time, you know, and he always runs well and he always picks up one or two every year.
Is Duvan keeping Altie or out of this race?
Just
in terms of the sense that would the temptation have been even greater? I mean, obviously everyone wanted to see the clash, but yeah, realistically that might mean you end up with no wins at all. But you just wonder whether or not you strike Duvan out of that list that we're looking at now, and the temptation must have been to a fast track to Altior.
Exactly, because if you look at Fox Norton, he's third favourite, and obviously Altior demolished him at Newbury the last day. As far as I know, he goes for the 2.5 for the Ryanair. But yeah, it probably is. But I think it'll be a clash for 12 months' time that we'll be talking about. Realistically, that's going to be the scenario. It'll be fascinating when it does happen. But I suppose at the end of the day, Altior, he's still a novice. I know he's been very good. And at the end, if you can win a race at Cheltenham, go and win it. Don't try and make things awkward, I don't think, anyway.
Yeah, okay. Matt, what's your view of this again, Duvan?
Yeah, and I'd love to see him do a Sprinter Sacral Mastermind and win by 19 lengths, something like that. One interesting point Kevin Blake made in the book this year is that he's run so much against Sizing John, and his least impressive performances in that line form have been at Cheltenham, whether it quite suits him as well. The highest rated horse he's actually run against is 159, and that's Gil Gamboa, who got that race in the National. You look at Altior's beaten 167 rated horse in Fox Norton. So he will be taking on much better horses here. I'm not saying for a moment he get beaten, I think he'll win easily. But it is a much bigger step up because he didn't run in the Tingle Creek as normally the second season horses do. If you're looking for a filthy each way burglar, taking up on that Special Tiara point, a lot of people are saying Special Tiara is on the downgrade, and as Richard mentioned, the two runs in bad ground, you can forgive him because he doesn't like that. But that run at Kempton in the Desert Orchid, he was getting £6 from Sir Valentino, who, you know, on fives had no chance at all, but would probably have won if he hadn't hit the second last. And he's 40-1 each way. He's strong at the end of his races. He's the sort of horse who might run on past horses who tried to mix it with Duvan. You can get a quarter of the odds. Be careful on the odds checker grid, but most of the bookmakers are still offering a quarter of the odds. So you're getting 10-1 the place, 9-2 even if you say he can't win. And I think there's a fair chance he could be placed because you could only have 6 or 7 runners in.
Yeah, and just on that final point, is this where the age-old argument comes back again about how the imposition, the upgrading of both the JLT and the Ryanair to sort of the mid-season things, you know, now forces means that you can duck a good horse in this sense?
Don't get me started. Yeah, I think the JLT is a race we have to abolish. You talk about the novice handicap chase, it's a £3 or £4 race. If we put that in two divisions, maybe a 2 mile 3 or 2 mile 5, got rid of the JLT, put penalties back in the 4 miler, then you'd have had Altior taking on York Hill in the Arkle, you'd have had a much more competitive RSA. It does look a bit of a weak event. Some of those good horses in the 4 miler have been running at it, and we'd have a much better spectacle to enjoy. So yeah, I'm definitely for that.
Okay, again, the remaining races, obviously the chief remaining race is the Weatherby's Champion Bumper. And we've also got the Coral Cup, the Cross Country, which is my nightmare race, and the Fred Winter. So any views on any of those, and we'll just work our way along?
Yeah, just a couple of them. If he runs, in the Cross Country, it's the cynic's view, they go round and round ever decreasing circles and the same horse wins. It's quite true because it's so tight, weight doesn't matter very much. And there are a whole load of stats in the book about that. But the French horse, Urgent de Gregain, if I pronounced it correctly, absolutely bolted up beating Cantlow in January. If they run him, and the French trainer, Gicleo, has apparently said he's worried about the extra weight, so I've sent him a message saying it doesn't matter because I've backed it. But he's £15 worse off with Cantlow. Baltazar King was £15 worse off with any currency than in the two conditions races. He beat him in either side and still beat him in this. I think he's still about 8 to 9 to 1 with a run because of that. Make sure you back him non-run and no bet. And at the risk of stealing Tom's thunder at the end, in the Coral Cup, I like Super Sunday, who I was even had my eye on for the Stayers Hurdle at big prices until recently. It sounds like Jessica's now going to run him in this. I think he's off 1.48. He's settling much better now. He's ruined his chance in the Supreme and Bumper by not settling. He's a little bit quirky, but that Coral Cup now is being won by class acts on the up, going towards graded races, and he could well be that. He's about 25 to 1, I think, so he's a decent price.
Okay. Jerry, there's a possibility that Nicky could have a runner in the Bumper this time around. He's never been overly positive about it before, but Daphne Duclos is second in, I think, with most bookmakers.
Yeah, he's not a massive fan of the Champion Bumper. Put it this way, he'd never tag a horse for the race. He might let one or two run it just for the experience, because it is an experience. It'll stand to them in 12 months' time if they line up in the Supreme, Neptune, etc. Daphne, she's a very likeable filly, and that's another thing. She'll be a filly taking on geldings again, which she was the last year on Newbury. Obviously, she was getting weight and things like that, but she's very talented. She won very impressively at Newbury, and she's a filly that's held in very high regard.
Is Devan Bear, who's in the Fred Winter, more like... I mean, obviously, the key line of form has been well franked with the Alan King horse that won the other day, and makes Devan Bear look pretty well handicapped. But a lot of these might come out, and Nicky was sort of suggesting that they might go the Triumph route. Do you know which way they might go?
Yeah, he's they're still kind of deciding.
Okay, she's open, yeah.
Exactly, because I think the way he was kind of saying it, if he lines up in the Fred Winter, he'll have top weight. But I suppose on ratings, he could be well handicapped if you do put lines of form through Master Blue Eyes, who's Devan Bear. He won well around here. He would have needed that, like he'd have improved for that run as well. He wouldn't have been wound up for his run around here when he beat Master Blue Eyes. He's a nice horse, he's improving. But I just mentioned the other horse too, is Dom Perignon Delice. Mm-hmm. He's a horse that I definitely think will line up in the Fred Winter. The owner's won it before, and he's keen to go back there again. He had one little blip in the copybook. He won very impressed there in Newcastle, and he just disappointed at Cheltenham. There might have been, I'm not too sure now, but there probably was a good reason for that, because he didn't came out and won very impressively at Market Raisin. And he's been a horse that's been trained for the race.
Okay, and finally, have you ever ridden around the cross country?
No, I haven't, but it's one race I would love to ride around, that's for sure.
Okay, very positive there. Tom?
Yeah, opposition to Cantlow in the cross country. When I say about to do a 12 days of Cheltenham, and he was our featured horse today and went 5 to 2. From midday, there was clearly money at 5 to 2 because it was a standout best price. But Cause of Causes and the French horse, we've seen money for both of those in that race. Cause of Causes, obviously, a festival winner. The Bumper, Carter Mackay, is a new scoop, fresh off the press, will be the featured horse tomorrow. We're going to go standout 4 to 1 for the Weatherby's Bumper tomorrow. So if you fancy Carter Mackay, not only will be 4 to 1 tomorrow, but the guys have said they'll go top price on him as a Mullins horse come the day. Coral Cup, the layers are wary of tacking Dussoy back over hurdles.
Quite right, they should be. Unfortunately, the owners don't want to run tacking Dussoy in the Coral Cup because they still cling to the belief that he's good enough to win a conditions race, which of course he's not. His mark of the Coral Cup is 1.48, and it's the same mark that very, very eye-catching run at Chepstow behind Bally Optic. If connections can be persuaded, you're right to fear him. He's a very, very big threat if he runs in the Coral Cup.
But hopefully we'll come second to Super Sunday.
Okay, right, a couple of others that I have. Well, actually, Willie Mullins, just on the Willie Mullins Bumper thing, because I'm going standout, there is quite an interesting Bumper stat, isn't there, in the book, I think, about Willie Mullins' horses in the Bumper.
Yeah, and it's actually pretty unusual for his shortest priced Bumper horse to do best. I think Willie admits himself, he runs anything that he thinks he's got a chance. They're improving so much, he often doesn't know at home. In the past, people just looked at what Ruby was riding. Of course, most people now know Patrick tends to have the choice of them. If you look at the value of the sort of horses that Champagne Fever was, second of three, Briar Hill was the outsider of three the year he won. Cousin Binny, I think, was second or third of the Malin's horses. So don't be afraid to look at one of his at a price. It's certainly paid in the past.
And just one other one that you might consider in the Fred Winter, a horse called Maggie Dumar, who is trained by David Pipe. They're reinstituting the bonus this year that was lapsed from the Imperial Cup. Pay very close attention to the five-day decks for the Imperial Cup next week, because Maggie Dumar could well be their bonus horse this year. Remember, Pipes have done it in the past, particularly with Gaspara, who was a young horse. Maggie Dumar's by no means certain to end up in the Fred Winter, but it looks the most likely option, because as you were telling me, the fact that she's got a rating of 140, but the weight for age means that that might struggle to get in anywhere else. So
yeah, I'm sure they'd love to run her in the Martin Pipe as part of the bonus, but it doesn't look like she'll get in there. But we'll get the 6 day confirmed during the week and we'll have a better idea then.
So basically, if you back her non-runner no bet, the option or the obvious thing is that if it doesn't win the Imperial Cup, it won't run, so you get your money back. If it does win the Imperial Cup, there's no way it'll be 20-1 if it lines up in the Fred Winter. You could argue you could back it for all of them, actually.
Yes. She's only going to run once.
Yeah, absolutely. So, but that is a potentially interesting horse, I think, in the Fred Winter. And I'm most looking forward to driving home at the end of ITV's coverage on Wednesday when the cross-country is finished. It's an amazing race, really, because, well, in terms of a race, they go round enough times and then the one that JP's on actually wins between the second last and the last. But, you know, the jockeys don't know whether they're going the right way. Commentators absolutely don't know whether. And even when they've gone the right way and it looks like they've gone the wrong way with Davy Russell, then they've gone the right way. So, you know, we just haven't a clue what the hell's going on, really. But, I mean, it's actually quite an interesting spectrum. If you ever walk the course, it is fascinating. It is really interesting. It does really help. But I know a lot of the riders steer clear of riding in it beforehand for the fear of going the wrong way. And, you know, my bravery award goes to whoever makes the running in that particular contest, I think.
Well, that's interesting because it's a quite good race for in-running punters, because you look at something like Any Currency last year, who looked a sitting duck out front, but it's actually very difficult to make the ground up. And if you look at where the winners have been in front over the last few years, they've been in front 3, 4, 5, 6 fences out. So for those of you who do like playing in running, that might be a good angle.
It just moves, you know, literally does twist and turn everywhere, and these races are either well packed, aren't they, in which case you've got the run of the race out in front, or they get strung out, and because you're on the turn, handing the horse 20 lengths advantage, where do you make it up when you're constantly, you know, going round? And
you saw Josie's orders last year, didn't you? Just get sighthounded 5 or 6 out, and you thought we've got plenty of time to make the ground up, and couldn't, and finish like a train.
Okay, so that brings us to the halfway stage. You can have a well-earned break. Thank you very much for your attention.